Imagine the chaos and just how bad it would be living in a country without a parliament. Actually, welcome to the English Civil Wars from History Workshops, a series of videos on anything and everything to do with the Wars of the Three Kingdoms, the causes, the characters, the battles, politics, the role of religion. We'll be doing some battlefield walks and so much more. So, to rule with or without a parliament was actually the choice that faced King Charles I in the late 1620s. With foreign wars going badly, with a nation attacking his wife's alien religion, his belief in the divine right of kings being assaulted, and meeting obstruction and frustration at every turn, Charles I eventually decided to rule without a parliament. A decision that was to be called either the personal rule or the 11 years tyranny. Let's see if firstly Charles was justified in his aims, or was it just another example of his rigid belief in the divine right of kings? Let's have a look.
Before we even discuss the details of Charles dissolving Parliament, we need to underline the fact that it was not actually illegal to rule without Parliament. But as we shall see, it proved unsustainable and ultimately reckless. The personal rule ran from 1629 to 1640. The king, as he would for the whole of his reign until his death, believed he had the absolute right, a royal prerogative, to rule alone, the divine right of kings. He had in fact dissolved Parliament three times already, and due to the harsh criticisms from Parliament and the signing of peace with France and Spain, these proved to Charles he could do without Parliament. The wars had been a disaster from start to finish, and had cost too much in arms, men and money, not to mention reputation. If you missed our video on the early wars of Charles I, there is a link in the description box below. Charles was also irritated by the constant attacks on his wife and her Catholicism. And once again, if Parliament did not sit, then there would be no centralised opposition to her. Again, if you missed our first part on the Queen's biography, there is also a link in the description box below. So on top of religious tensions, financial pressures, and games of power in shadowy corridors, matters finally came to a head in 1629 with the Three Resolutions. Simply, the issue centred on the fear of the growing presence of Arminianism in the Church of England, as well as the controversial bill of tonnage and poundage. Tonnage and poundage was a medieval tax on wine and mercantile goods being imported and exported. For most kings, this had been granted for life, but not so for Charles I. Seems a bit unfair, you may think, but Parliament had their reasons. For in King Charles' father's reign, the money received from tonnage and poundage had been spent by King James frivolously. Not receiving this tax for life was seen by Charles and his supporters as a direct attack on the king, an attack which denied him a main source of income and to force him to apply for money every year. In other words, to be in need of Parliament. An edgy game of power had begun. But despite the House of Commons passing the bill, it was blocked by the House of Lords, led by the Duke of Buckingham. However, Parliament still refused to grant any tonnage and poundage rights, and with them also attempting to impeach Charles' main advisor, the Duke of Buckingham, Charles dissolved Parliament. With his stubborn streak, or his unbreakable resolve, Charles continued to collect import and export taxes. With Parliament refusing to back down, the King commanded Sir John Finch, the Speaker of the House of Commons, to adjourn the House. But before he could, he was pinned down in the chair by the members of Parliament. He was held there until the three resolutions had been voiced. Whilst this was happening, the doors were barred, and as Denzel Hollis read out the complaints, the King's officials hammered at the door. Although no vote was taken, the MPs roared their assent. It was pandemonium inside and outside of the House. The King and members of Parliament were both shocked at how heated events were getting and the carriage of diverse fiery spirits. Very soon after, Charles proclaimed the dissolution of Parliament in March 1629. In his speech, the King maintained his right to receive tonnage and poundage without the say-so of Parliament, despite Parliament branding anyone who paid it enemies of the kingdom and betrayers of the liberties of England. On the next day, the king pounced on his chief enemies, primarily Sir John Eliot, Denzel Hollis, and William Strode. They were arrested and imprisoned, and so began the personal rule, or the 11 years tyranny. Just like the causes of the English Civil Wars, the actual cause of the king's dissolving of Parliament for 11 years are murky and ill-defined. The cause is more likely a collection of arguments, differences of opinion, an unwillingness to relinquish power. It all led to the king's party and Parliament becoming so entrenched that meaningful discourse between them was impossible to achieve. Events such as the Petition of Rights, which will be a topic of a future video, would divide the king from his Parliament. A year before the king dissolved Parliament, this petition set out a specific document which gave individuals certain protections from the state, including habeas corpus, no billeting of soldiers or sailors in private houses, and no one to be forced to provide loans or taxes without an act of Parliament. So let's now have a look at the two main problems between Crown and Parliament, problems which still afflict us to this very day, religion and money. A key belief of Charles I was that in his role as king and as head of the church, there was only one authority greater than his, and that belonged to God. His dislike of the more Puritan factions of the Protestant church was due to there being no need for bishops. The Puritan church believed religion should be a very personal and individual relationship with God. There was no need for priests or bishops to get in the way. No respect for the authority of bishops meant no respect for the authority of the king, who was, after all, head of the Church of England. But without Parliament sitting, Charles and his Privy Council were able to work on their plans for the church unheeded, at least to begin with. Charles was often accused of being a Catholic, or at least leant heavily towards Catholicism. But no, he was a supporter of the High Church, or Arminianism, which centred on more ritual, colour and ceremony. This form of worship was to go head to head with the more Puritan factions, who believed the Reformation had not gone far enough. Charles was faced with a huge challenge, however, for it was not only in England he wanted to change how his subjects worshipped, but in Wales, Scotland and Ireland. It would be this challenge that he would not succeed in, and would lead directly to civil war. The man who would be forever linked to Charles I's religious innovations was one William Laud, Archbishop of Canterbury. Laud, despite opponents at court, pushed through strict reforms and insisted that all services use the Book of Common Prayer. On top of this, he placed clergymen he could trust into churches, sometimes forcibly, by using the authority of the Star Chamber. Parish churches were also angered by episcopal visitations to ensure the new legislation was being carried out. So what exactly was Laud trying to force onto churches and the congregation? What would anger them so much? Laud wanted to bring the altar back to the east end of the church. He believed that people should kneel to receive Holy Communion. Clergy should wear a surplice. Bowing brought back at the name of Jesus, railed altars, making the sign of the cross, and reinstalling stained glass windows. The communion table was also a source of ferocious debate. Under Queen Elizabeth, these would be put at the east end of the church and brought into the body of the chancel for communion. For the Arminians, this was all way too rough and ready. Laud was horrified at going into churches where the communion table was covered with schoolboy satchels and hats, or parishioners using them for a business meeting. There was nothing here about the beauty of holiness. Even less so when dogs could saunter into the church and relieve themselves on the table. The communion table reflects Archbishop Laud's controversial altar policy, which aimed to show greater respect for Holy Communion. Laudian policy was all about introducing formality, order, and ceremony into the order of service. Enthusiastic clergy started replacing their wooden communion tables with grand stone altars, ornaments, sparkly candlesticks, crucifixes and plates, and things started to be found proudly adorning the altar. One of the scenes in the 1970 Cromwell film, which is fairly true to life, is where Richard Harris as Cromwell sweeps all the ornaments from the altar of his parish church, grace, sending them clattering to the floor.
Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Who has done this? Answer me. Who has done this?
An edict, squire, from the Archbishop himself, and by order of the king.
By order of the king? Is the Church of England not a Protestant church? Would the king turn the house of God into a Roman temple?
Mr. Cromwell, I beseech you.
Does the king think that God can be bought with gold, trinkets, and gilded rubbish?
I know only that I have been instructed.
Has this king forgotten the Reformation?
Mr. Cromwell,
I... Away with this popish idolatry! Say unto Moses, thou shalt not make unto thyself any graven image. Thou bow down to them.
To modern eyes, it may seem small fry, but the poet John Milton gives some idea of what this meant. The table of communion now became a table of separation, stands like an exalted platform upon the brow of the choir, fortified with bulwark and barricado, to keep off the profane touch of the laity, which is what the prelates desire, that when they have brought us back to popish blindness, we might commit to their disposal the whole management of our salvation. To modern eyes, these changes may seem trivial, but to the 17th century population, these were alterations consisting of great danger. All of the above were seen by the Puritan minority, not the population at large, it is to be noted, that Laud and the king were trying to reintroduce popery. For Laud, it was a policy of the beauty of holiness. This phrase was from Psalm 96, which stated that the worship should be full of ceremony and splendour. His aim was for colour, splendour, and above all, uniformity across King Charles's three kingdoms. But above all, amongst all these reforms, it would be Laud's and the king's insistence of the use of the Book of Common Prayer that would do the most damage. The idea of this publication would be to regulate and to bring uniformity to the church across all of Charles's nations. It would reduce preaching and showing greater respect for the sacraments, dangerously close to a Catholicism in many eyes. King and Archbishop were both playing a dangerous game. Perhaps the most infamous of Charles's personal rule policy was ship money. Now, like dissolving Parliament, ship money was not illegal, but again, it was how Charles went about collecting it and enforcing his demands. In fact, his father James I had received no unpopular press by levying £40,000 from London and nearly £9,000 from the other seaport towns in 1619. Ship money was permitted to be collected from coastal towns in times of national defence. Now, when Charles dissolved Parliament, the country was still at war with Spain, and the French War was coming to a close. But two factors angered the public when Charles requested ship money to be collected. One, the wars were very unpopular, so people did not want to contribute towards it. And two, Charles had increased ship money to all counties, not just coastal ones. So without Parliament, the king began to issue demands for money in the region of £173,000, roughly 31 million in today's money. This huge amount of money was in stark contrast to a recent petition sent to the king stating that your subjects have inherited this freedom, that they should not be compelled to contribute to any tax, tallage, aid, or other like charge not set by common consent in Parliament. Charles I knew that this policy was deeply unpopular and divisive, and so attempted to camouflage the real reason for the policy. He published his belief that ship money and its collection was essential due to increased danger of piracy on commercial shipping, along with general unrest in Europe. The first writ that Charles issued received strong opposition from some quarters, while none in others. London claimed exemption. Some towns argued the exact amounts that needed to be paid, yet Charles still netted over £100,000. Charles, seeing that ship money could reap some rewards for the crown, issued a second writ in 1635, However, this writ hit sterner opposition. This time, £208,000 was demanded from all counties. It was now seen that the king wanted to use his policy continually to be rid of Parliament for good. The king attempted to bolster his position by issuing a declaration signed by 10 out of 12 judges. It read that in time of national danger, of which the crown was the sole judge, ship money might legally be levied on all parts of the country by writ under the Great Seal. Charles's third and final writ to wring money from the British public occurred in 1636. As before, judges were used to assist in the matter, and they returned a favourable answer to the Star Chamber. But the king was to confront real opposition, which was to harden the population against his ship money policy. A certain John Hampden, who was a rich Buckinghamshire gentleman, refused to pay. This case, which was to become a national sensation, was heard before 12 judges. Hampden and his legal team argued that the taxes demanded by the king were illegal. Ship money could be seen as illegal, as not ratified by Parliament, but also full of incompetence and corruption. A fine example of this was the construction of HMS Sovereign of the Seas, which was a brand new 100-gun warship. This Leviathan took 3 years to build and cost five times as much as a normal ship of the line, mainly due to the gold gilt on the stern. Instead of it being used to batter the king's enemies on the high seas, it was primarily used to move gold bullion to Flanders to pay for the king's armies in service there. The ship was so large and so much a prestige project that real concerns were raised. One concern stated, "There is no port in the kingdom that can harbour this ship. The wild sea must be her port, her anchors and cables her safety. If either fail, the ship must perish. The king lose his jewel. 400 or 500 men must die, and perhaps some great and noble peer." But no matter where the money was being spent, Hampden lost his case by a small margin of 7 judges to 5. But despite this, the case being a victory for the king, it turned out to be an embarrassment at the closeness of the verdict. The indecision amongst the judges encouraged others to refuse to pay ship money. By 1639, less than 20% of the tax demanded was actually collected. With one of his main income streams drying up, his foreign wars leaking away much needed funds, and with an expensive court to maintain, Charles had been backed into a corner. It was his religious policies that would eventually force his hand in recalling a parliament in 11 years. The king and his Archbishop Laud began forcing the Book of Common Prayer on the Scottish Church, and very soon, rebellion would erupt. But that's a tale for another video.
So, what do you think? Was Charles right in ruling without Parliament? Had Parliament bullied the king and given the king no choice? Do you think the personal rule could have worked out if handled differently? Let us know in the comments below. If you've missed any of our previous videos in our English Civil War series, there is a link here and in the description box below. As always, thanks for watching. Please give us a subscribe. And of course, God save the King.